KFI AM 640, more stimulating talk.
I have a sign in my office. Is Diet Pepsi okay? And the answer is Monopoly money okay?
Bill Handel, mornings from 6 to 10 on KFI. AM with George Norrie.
We are going to take your calls with Brandon Beecham next hour, author of The Golden Key, so get ready for that. We're going to talk with him more when we come back in just a moment. ParanormalDate.com, cruising along, 118 people to go, and we hit 111,000 signed up members. Free to sign up, give it a try at ParanormalDate.com.
And you know, if you like that senior crowd, you can head over to ParanormalDate.com/seniors and meet that like-minded people that are 60-plus. Like-minded seniors, they're right at your fingertips. It really all depends on what you prefer. Now, we've got ParanormalDate.com, and that's great for everyone. We've also got ParanormalDate.com/seniors for those that are 60-plus. Whatever you do, we want you to enjoy your search. Have some fun. ParanormalDate.com.
At ParanormalDate.com, you meet the most fantastic people.
Hi, I'm Tom.
Hi, I'm Jennifer. What brings you here?
Yeah, I'm here to meet someone who understands me.
How so?
Well, I'm into UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot, conspiracy theories, the paranormal, that kind of stuff. But can't seem to find anyone who gets it.
Oh, well, nice to meet you, Tom. I gotta go.
Okay, guess that's not your cup of tea. You sure?
Very. Good luck with that.
I can't meet anyone when I'm out, and I really can't find a website for my unique interests. What does one to do?
Have you thought about ParanormalDate.com?
Para-what-dot-what? Who are you?
I'm a paranormal matchmaker, and it's ParanormalDate.com. It's a website for people looking for people like them. Stuff you like, remember?
Interesting. I'll give it a try.
Well, let's try this again.
Hi, I'm Tom.
Hey, I'm Deb. Your profile on ParanormalDate.com looked very interesting. So you really saw a UFO?
Well, yeah. It was so intense, but not as intense as meeting you.
You're an alien chasing flirt, but I kinda like it.
Wow, this ParanormalDate.com thing really works.
Maybe ParanormalDate.com is for you. People with an interest in things they hear on George's show find their match daily. So if you're looking for that special someone with an interest in UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot, conspiracy theories, and, of course, the paranormal, come to the dating site inspired by George Norrie. It's always free to search, and if you decide to upgrade to our amazing new features, use promo code George for a great discount. ParanormalDate.com. You are not alone.
This message is sponsored by BetterHelp. Is there something interfering with your own happiness or preventing you from achieving your own goals? BetterHelp will assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist, just for you. You can start communicating in under 48 hours. It's not a crisis line. It's not self-help. It's professional counseling done securely online. And there's a broad range of expertise available that may not be locally available to you in many areas, hence you do it this way. And you get timely and thoughtful responses, and you can schedule weekly video or phone sessions so you won't ever have to sit in an uncomfortable waiting room as with traditional therapy. That's more affordable than traditional offline counseling, and financial aid is available. Visit BetterHelp.com/George. That's BetterHelp, H-E-L-P, and join the more than 1 million people who have taken charge of their mental health with the help of an experienced professional. Special offer for you? Get 10% off the first month at BetterHelp.com/George.
Born from the tragedy on 9/11, the Tunnel to Towers Foundation carries forward a legacy of courage and heroism. For the 20th anniversary of 9/11 this year, Tunnel to Towers is helping America's heroes and their families with 120 mortgage-free homes, bringing stability to 120 Gold Star and fallen first responder families with young children, and smart homes to our nation's most catastrophically injured veterans and first responders. In honor of the fallen, the foundation's chairman and CEO, Frank Siller, is embarking on the Never Forget Walk, more than 500 miles through six states in 42 days, starting at the Pentagon on August 1st, through to Shanksville, Pennsylvania, and culminating at Ground Zero on 9/11. Towers of Light will shine at the Pentagon and Shanksville memorials in remembrance again this year. Thanks to your support, the words Never Forget require action. Take action now. Join Tunnel to Towers on its mission to do good. Donate $11 a month at T2T.org. That's T, the number 2T.org.
And welcome back to Coast, George Norrie back with you along with Brandon Beecham, author of The Golden Key. Brandon, tell me about the title, The Golden Key.
The Golden Key. Well, let's see. The subject matter for the book actually came to me in a dream.
Most powerful things happen that way.
It seems to be. August 6th, actually, 2020, I had a dream about, okay, here's what to do next. Here's the book. Here's the basic content, and here's the unique way that you should distribute it. And so I sort of woke up from the dream, and as it settled in, I started to get excited about it, and I knew, you know, that excitement, if it continued and sustained, then, you know, sometimes we have ideas, and then they fizzle quickly, and it's, you know, maybe that's a sign that it's not really for you. If it continues to grow and that excitement stays, that I really start paying attention. So it was really just building from the time I woke up over the coming hours. And so I started thinking, well, what would I call this book?
And you self-published, didn't you?
I did. I decided to self-publish because of the way that I'm distributing it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so, yeah, I did a search to see, has anyone used the name Golden Key? And turns out Emmett Fox, guy, I don't know if you're familiar with him, about 100 years ago, 1931, almost 100 years, he wrote a well-known essay called The Golden Key.
Uh-huh.
And I got chills when I saw it pop up when I did a search, and the description was like, you know, read this and just try it and see for yourself. And that's exactly how I had dreamed, like, look, do this playful kind of gamification thing and invite people to apply the ideas in the book and see for themselves. So I knew I was on the right track then. it's maybe a next edition, 100 years later, in a sense, carrying Emmett's work forward in some way, shape, or form energetically.
Synchronicity is incredible. Now, you talk about eight keys. Can you just rattle them off for us?
I would love to rattle them off, and I'd like to add one more thing to this. So,
sure.
So I go to my dear friend Vajra, who's one of the most epic visionary artists in the world, and I was thinking I would love for Vajra to create the cover art for the book. However, I know his process. It's very distinct, and, you know, it takes him a long time, and I'm trying to get this out fairly quickly. I end up contacting him and saying, hey, Vajra, I had this dream. I went, and then I found a synchronicity with, you know, Emmett Fox and the Golden Key, and similar in the gamification aspect I'm tying in, and I'd love for you to do the art if you have time. And he goes, okay, you done with your spiel, Brandon? And I'm like, yep. He goes, let me get out my dream journal and he gets it out and he starts reading. This is my dream from 2 months ago, 3 months ago, something like that. He's like, I help run a communal property in Venice, California, LA area,
yeah,
called Mystic Manor. And he said, I had a dream. I was at the Mystic Manor, and I was hunting for the key to everything. And so he read this elaborate dream about the key to everything, and he said, so to answer your question, will I do the cover art? I started it 3 months ago from this inspiring dream that I had hunting for the key to everything.
Oh, my
property. So, yeah, it worked out.
Right. So these eight keys, rattle them off.
Yep. Okay, so the first key, see the oneness. The second key, know the illusion. The third key, focus your flow. The fourth key, align your intentions. The fifth key, B, B, B. The sixth key, trust the mystery. The seventh key, love what comes. And the eighth key, the golden key that ties them all together, master the Y-O-U universe. Master the universe.
And they're all important. One without the other doesn't work, does it?
You know, yeah, it really is, you know, a puzzle, right? You put all these together and the sum is greater than the equal parts. Will you get results by utilizing one of the keys and not the other? Sure. But there's something to be said for putting, you know, all the pieces of a puzzle together, right? Or all the parts in a car to get the results that you, you know, the optimal results.
You talked about, Brandon, a synchronicity story that was directly related to Coast to Coast. What was that?
Okay. Well, let's see.
Here we go.
Probably my first really significant. I think, you know, it's funny because I share so many synchronicity stories on my podcast that tie in with listeners, and I have a friend who every time he sees me, he's like, Mr. Synchronicity. So it's funny to think how that's something that I've become very known for, and I always ask that as an interview question on my own show. And but going back to 2006, I was listening to Coast AM, and you had a caller call in, and he called in and said he was from the year 2063. And, you know, I can't remember if it was Art Bell or I don't know when, you know, if it was you back then. It was so long ago. But whoever was, you know, running the show that night just kind of laughed and was like, oh, okay, Mr. Time Traveler, you know. And the guy was very logical and was you know, oh, no, I'm not in your time, but time is an illusion, so I can communicate backwards. He had some very, you know, intelligent answers. So then the host goes, okay, well, fair enough. Well, what do you got to share with us tonight? And he goes, well, I want to talk about 2012 because, you know, in your timeline, people think it's going to be the end of the world. And it's actually the beginning of a new, you know, era and kind of going down that. And then the host asks, well, what's one of the things that contributes to this, you know, new era, this awakened era for humanity? And the guy started going into a plan that I had been developing at the time. What led up to ResortShare was a music distribution platform that I created. And I had this idea. I just went to Burning Man for the first time right before this.
Yeah.
And so I was really obsessed with community and, you know, creating a permanent village infrastructure. And I had this idea for, I was in a band for many years and, you know, creating a music platform, an online kind of record label distribution platform thing. And the guy starts going into, well, there's this guy and he creates this record label and him and all his friends put their money together and, you know, it ends up causing, you know, so successful, it ends up creating, you know, everyone in this community, they go from a virtual community to a permanent community kind of thing. And then they start sharing, you know, everyone just contributes where they should. There's no money here. And then they start sharing outside of the community. And this ultimately disrupts the dollar in a good way. And at the time, it was like the idea is like creating this community. And I had this idea was very close to my chest at the time, my big idea for this music distribution platform. And I'm hearing him talk about kind of, you know, the basic visions of it. So I was like, okay, I don't want to be completely crazy. Universe, if this sign was for me, I mean, if this message was somehow for me, then I want to see or hear the name. The guy said his name was Omar. I said, I want to see or hear the name Omar, you know, within the next 24 hours, something, you know, it's not a name that comes into my field very often. Next morning, I'm driving somewhere, I'm telling my brother about it on the phone, I look over and I'm in front of a place called Omar's Print Shop. And fast forward several years, I'm, you know, haven't launched this thing yet, and I'm in it, having a moment of like, oh my gosh, I should just launch this. This is my dream to create this platform, and I should just quit everything and do it. Universe, if I should, give me that sign again that you gave me years ago, you know, in 2006, Omar. I go and pick my son up from school. He begs me to see a friend he hasn't seen in 2 years who lives 30 minutes away. I agree reluctantly, and we go. This kid gets in the car, hasn't seen my son in 2 years. First thing out of his mouth, Oh, Bradley, my dad just took me to Omar's Bird Shop. Omar. The kid would not shut up about Omar. 3 hours later, dinner. Did I tell you about Omar yet? So, I quit everything. I started that distribution platform. It grew to thousands of users. It was like, you know, think Spotify in 2010, but with where, you know, there's like sharing the abundance and even like balloons, which are kind of like cryptocurrency today, sharing it with everyone. And I ran out of money and it didn't develop into what Omar's vision was in 2006, you know, maybe in a different timeline, but it helped to get me there. And then from that, I ran out of resources. And then there was some tragedy with my brother's girlfriend, took her life.
Oh, yeah.
I just kind of hit rock bottom where it's like, okay, I need more abundance. And that's when resort share came into my field. And I've never went back to it. So it didn't quite, you know, manifest as that Omar told. But Omar's popped up a couple times since, you know, that name in very weird ways, maybe one or two other times. And it was really impactful for me.
It sounds like one of the things you've done successfully, Brandon, is you're resilient. You don't seem to give up.
Yeah, I think it's like the Chinese proverb, fall down 7 times, stand up 8. I think that is such a key, George, for people too. It isn't over if you haven't won. And so, you know, you either learn or you win. And so if you can just trust, you know, one of the keys, trust the mystery. I can have an idea about what I think I should be doing next, but really as my human, you know, as my human consciousness, I'm playing checkers and my higher self is playing chess, right? So I'm gonna have the vision based off of where I should navigate to next, based off of the information at hand and my highest excitement and all the factors, with a sense of detachment, knowing my higher self, who I'm doing this dance with, is playing chess. It's seeing the board from a whole different vantage point. So what I think is in my best interest, it may be right, and it may not. But when you get into that field of, okay, I trust it. As a master, you know, mastery is someone embracing what shows up because they know exactly what they need to get to the next greatest and greatest version of themselves. So I think through a lot of practice, of not getting what I want, it's really helped me to sharpen my axe. And, you know, smooth seas never made for a skilled sailor, and we all came to be skilled sailors. So I think, you know, you start to realize, okay, there may be rough waters, just keep going.
We're going to take calls next hour with Brandon Beacon, so get ready to make some calls. And if you want to share a story or two with us, go ahead and do that. It seems to me that this is almost some kind of magic that's involved in this, is there?
You know, yes, magic is real. Abracadabra translates to, I create as I speak. Our words are our wands. We are spelling. When we speak, we're spelling. We're casting a spell. So, you know, Henry Ford put it very, very simply, you know, not in such magical terms, whether you think you can or think you can't, you're right. And that's because we are the creator. We are the creator and created rolled into one. So if I'm looking through, you know, if I'm looking through the lens of life is magical and, you know, everything is happening for me and there's magic around every corner and synchronicity and serendipity, and it may not always be easy, but it's going to be worth it. And I have that, you know, that adventurous, childlike spirit, then, you know, abracadabra. Oh, that's how it is for you? And so it is. If I told a different story, then it will show up that way. You know, there's really only one truth, your truth. We are so powerful, we're creating it all. And so the more you step into the magical perspective, the more magic you see.
And do we have free will, or are things already determined for us?
This is a great question. You know, the way I look at it, I say that our lives play out at the corner of free will and destiny. And it's destined because, well, you know, Einstein proved, you know, time is an illusion, for example.
Right.
If you shoot me into outer space and bring me back a day later, I'm a day older and you may have been gone for a dozen years, right? You know, we know that time is illusory. Your fifth birthday party is happening on another channel. You're just not tuned into it right now. And so that helps to really solidify the idea of destiny. Oh, it's already happening. It's happening on different channels. And
So, however, I believe free will comes in where, you know, source, God, higher self, the universe, consciousness, whatever you want to call it, it is infinite, infinitely abundant, so it plays out all the possibilities. And that includes, you know, the first intuitive reading I ever had, George, I was in Atlanta, Georgia. I sat in front of the woman and she goes, I see you in a cold place like Chicago working in business. Now, my jaw hit the floor because I was planning to move to Chicago and work in business with my uncle at that moment in college when I graduated. And then she said, but there's this whole other path in California and music. And a year later, I ended up forming a band, started having my own awakening, and met someone from California, came out to visit, and here we are, you know, 20-some years later. And so what was she seeing in that moment? The potential Brandons, as I sat in front of her. Well, oh, what timelines is this particular Brandon vibrating closest to? Oh, I see the Chicago version, and I see the California version. And so, you know, the way I look at it is, okay, so it's all already happened, right? But there's also free will within that of potential timelines. Well, which one do you want to experience? The greatest and grandest version, right? The one that's the most fulfilling. And since time is an illusion, source has already been there, done that, and gotten the t-shirt. So, you know, how you step into that timeline, you I like to say you be it to see it, right?
Is it real?
Is it real? Is it an illusion? Yes.
Simulation. You know, Elon Musk says we're not really here.
Yeah. And you know, it's relative truths, right? You know, from one vantage point, I can say it's very real, and another, it's an illusion, and both are true. Or I can say you and I are separate. That's true. We can make an argument for that. Most people would agree with. I can say you and I are one. Many people on this, listening to this, tuning into this show, would agree with that. So it's what vantage point from which are we speaking? There certainly is a lot of evidence pointing to the idea that this is, you know, a simulation, and that we are, as Nick Bostrom talked about, you know, ancestor simulations, and that in his simulation argument, he talks about the three potentials of what would happen with an advanced civilization. Well, any civilization, they get to the point where they kill themselves off before becoming post-human, getting past all the problems of the world, or they get to that point, but they opt for low technology, or three, they get to that point and they opt to continue to advance technologically, in which case they would most certainly create simulations of themselves, right? And so it only takes one, you know, ancestor to be able to create billions, who knows how many simulations they could create. And that's why you have people like Elon Musk saying, hey, it's one in a billions of chance that we're not, you know, that we are in a base level reality, because the odds kind of point to, there's more and more evidence pointing to this being a simulation. But why does a simulation happen? So you can train in a safe environment.
Well, let's hope they don't shut it off.
Yeah, right. It's like, if you're going to become a fighter pilot, they don't throw you up in the sky at first. They put you in a simulator. So when you crash and burn, you don't really die.
And you learn.
Think of it like this. You're in a simulation practicing, so when you get into a bigger arena and the stakes are higher, you're more prepared.
We're going to come back, Brandon, and take phone calls with you. The book, The Golden Key.
Find out more about tonight's guest. Log on to coasttocoastam.com.
Something from this show every day?
You're wrong.
You're absolutely wrong.
Gary and Shannon, weekdays at 10 a.m. on KFI.
Masks don't slow us down. They keep us moving. From the store to the park for a pickup game. At the movies. Or at the gym. Keep wearing a snug-fitting mask with multiple cloth layers. Together, we can end this pandemic. Visit covid19.ca.gov today to learn more. brought to you by the Center at Sierra Health Foundation.
Getting families vaccinated against COVID-19 is an important step to bringing back joy for all of us. That's within reach now that the Pfizer vaccine is proven safe and effective for those 12 and older. This is the same vaccine millions of Californians have already gotten. California is even adding new vaccine clinics specifically for young people. Together, we can end the pandemic. Visit vaccinateall58.com or call 833-422-4255 to learn more. It was a beautiful June morning in Southern California.
Birds were chirping, the sun was shining.
And somewhere on a quiet residential street, a sink was clogging.
The couple experiencing the clog,
Mr. and Mrs. JP,
did something they had never done before. They called the Smell Good Plumbers at Mike Diamond.
I'm Mike Diamond. I guarantee my plumbers will show up on time and unclog your sink for $99.
The technicians showed up promptly and unclogged the sink.
A few months later, a much more intensive problem turned up in the bathroom.
Mr. JP called Mike Diamond again. They worked up a plan and the repair was made.
Mr. and Mrs. JP felt good enough about the experience to sit down and write us an email.
They commended the Smell Good Plumbers on their service and closed by saying they would use Mike Diamond on future services and recommend them to anyone in need of plumbing repairs.
We love Mr. and Mrs. JP, and we'd love for you to read their testimonial and more before calling your next plumber. The address is MikeDiamond.com, or just call us at 1-800-446-MIKE. Contractor's license number 399-170.
You'll figure it out eventually. We can help. KFI AM 640 Los Angeles, Orange County.
And KOSD HD2.
It's 5 a.m. What did you miss?
It's time for Wake Up Call with Jennifer Jones Lee.
Well, good morning, and welcome to a Wednesday. All right, it felt a little more normal this morning. So if you were like me, and yesterday when you were coming to work, you thought, what in the world? Where did all these people come from? I think what happened is a lot of people didn't come home on Memorial Day specifically. They saw that as a whole nother day to vacay. All right, I get it. And they thought, I'll just come home on Tuesday. But I think a whole lot of people thought that. As I was driving out of my neighborhood this morning, all I saw were boats parked out on the street, the occasional RV that looks like it had just come back up from a trip, people, you know, dune buggies and four-wheelers and everything hanging out, and I thought, oh, okay, now I see what happened. Lots to talk about this morning on your wake-up call. Of course, we start with the tragedy out of Agua Dulce, and the LA County Fire Department is mourning the firefighter who was shot and killed at a fire station. Hundreds of friends and family members of the community as well all joined a vigil near Fire Station 81, and a judge has rejected a resentencing plea for a woman who admitted to killing her son in Palmdale. 505, we'll talk with ABC's Jim Ryan. This is fascinating to me. First off, did you know every year almost 500,000 people in the U.S. are burned? Some sort of accident, they get burned, right? And that the 500,000, that's just the people who actually seek treatment for the burns. But there's some incredible new hope for burn victims. Spray on skin. Spray on skin. We'll find out about it in just a few minutes. But let's start with some of these stories coming out of the KFI 24-hour newsroom. The LA County Fire Department has been processing the loss of a firefighter at the hands of a fellow firefighter.
Fire Chief Daryl Onsby says the tragedy was compounded as more details came to light.
We learned that the shooter was an off-duty firefighter who came to the fire station.
Onsby says the firefighter shot and killed a firefighter engineer yesterday and then shot and wounded a fire captain. Deputies went to the shooter's home to find it on fire and the shooter dead of an apparent suicide. Now Onsby says the department is mourning the on-duty loss of a firefighter.
He never thought that if it occurred, that it would occur in this fashion.
Meanwhile, investigators are working to understand why the shooter chose the violent course he did. In Santa Clarita, Chris Ancarlo, KFI News.
Hundreds of friends and family members of the community held a vigil near Fire Station 81. LA County Fire spokesman Jonathan Matheny says they wanted to pay tribute and support the family affected by the shooting.
This is the most difficult day that I personally have ever experienced with the Los Angeles County Fire Department, seeing our brothers, our sisters in harm's way in this manner.
A procession of LA County Fire and Sheriff's Department vehicles went from Fire Station 81 to the county coroner's office in Boyle Heights early this morning. A judge has rejected a resentencing plea for a woman who admitted to killing her son in Palmdale.
The judge said Pearl Fernandez is not entitled to resentencing because of her own admission the murder was intentional and involved the infliction of torture over a period of several months. Fernandez and her boyfriend admitted to the death of 8-year-old Gabriel Fernandez. The mother got life without parole. The boyfriend got the death penalty. Fernandez filed a petition in April that she couldn't be convicted of first or second degree murder because of recent changes made in state law. But the judge ruled yesterday Fernandez did not qualify. Steve Gregory, KFI News.
Well, the first state task force in the nation to study and recommend reparations for the descendants of slavery has been held in California. Governor Newsom says the first meeting yesterday is an important step for the state and the entire country.
As our country reckons with our painful legacy of racial injustice, California, again, is poised to lead the way. Lead the way towards a more equitable and inclusive future for all.
The task force is made up of 9 members who will work over the next 2 years to look at how slavery has impacted black people and figure out the logistics of how the reparations would work and who's eligible. LA County's COVID-19 numbers continue to get better. Health officials say the adjusted case rate for the virus dropped from 9 new cases per 100,000 to 7 per 100,000. And the overall positivity rate in countywide dropped from 5% to 4%. State health officials say they're pleased with the new numbers, and that helps keep the county in the less restrictive yellow tier indefinitely. And we also learned a California Workplace Safety Board is expected to consider easing mask and physical distancing requirements for workers when it meets tomorrow. The proposal would let workers ditch their masks if everyone in a room is fully vaccinated and doesn't have COVID-19 symptoms. The plan would also make people who work indoors or at big outdoor events either social distance or be offered a respirator-like N95 mask. All right, when we come back, we're going to talk with ABC's Jim Ryan about spray-on skin for burn victims. I think it's an incredible creation. Right now, let's see what's up with your drive. Good morning, Robin Banks. What's going on the 110?
Hi, Jen. Let's go to Carson on the 110 northbound just after the 405. It is a wreck that is blocking the left lane. Just a very slight delay for you as you make your way through that scene. Just kind of slow down and move over. Make sure that you're safe. In Acton on the 14 northbound just before Sierra Highway, wreck here moved over to the right shoulder. CHP still sitting there on scene, so you're looking at a little bit of a delay right around Escondido Canyon. In Corona and then one westbound before Auto Center, that's a wreck up against the center divider in the fast track lanes with CHP's lights flashing on scene. In Upland on the 210 eastbound at campus, wreck moved to the center divider area, so heads up to a traffic break most likely at some point. If you're driving in the meantime, a little bit slow from Mountain Avenue. KFI in the sky helps get you there faster. I'm Robin Banks.
506 on your wake-up call, KFI AM 640 live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. Jim Ryan, good morning. And I think let's start out first with 500,000 people in the U.S. are the victim of a burn. Yep. And that's just the people who are reporting it?
Well, yeah, the ones who need hospital treatment, people, elderly people who suffer burns from scalding, for example, industrial workers who are involved in accidents on the job site. Half a million every year, just really a dramatic number, and I don't think you think about it much. Huh. Firefighters out there on the front lines of forest fires or fighting house fires. And increasingly, physicians are using something that has nothing to do with skin grafts, but has to do with skin stem cells. A patient comes into an operating room, for example, Jen. The doctor removes a small portion of skin, about the size of a quarter in many cases. That is then reduced down. The stem cells are pulled out of it. They're reduced into a spray, which is then reapplied to the burn area. And doctors are finding that they're having really great success with this. A quick recovery time, which means less trauma to the patient, less cost to the insurance industry, and a much better result. The skin pigmentation returns to what it was almost to perfection compared to what the skin graft is able to offer.
Wow. I think what's so neat about it is it's your own body sort of recreating itself, I guess, if you will.
Right, and healing those damaged parts of the body using stem cells. So I think the conversation started really about 20 years ago. This has been around for a few years, but I think it doesn't get much play. You don't hear much about it unless you end up being burned seriously or you're in that medical profession in dermatology or something. So, but I think it's going to be used much more widely around the country as it gains acceptance. and the cost of it starts to come down. And really, it's a remarkably cost-effective way to do things, because the time that it takes is much shorter. People are in the hospital a shorter time, and the recovery results are pretty strong.
Okay, going back to that word acceptance that you used, because usually anytime you hear stem cells, it becomes something controversial. Have you seen any of that?
Well, no, because you're not using the stem cells from anyone but yourself. Right, you're not using it from fetuses or any other source. They simply come from the skin that is close to from the same area as the burn portion. It comes off that same patient, and it's spun out to get the stem cells and then put into a spray. So I wish I had some further context to bring this up, but I saw the story and thought it was fascinating.
Oh, yeah.
This is actually going on. It's like something that Dr. McCoy would have carried in his medical team.
Exactly. You know? That is a great analogy. Thank you so much, Jim. I know, honestly, this is way behind baseball here, but to tell people, at night I get a list of all the different things that all the ABC reporters are offering, and this story was by far the most fascinating to me. So, Jim, thank you.
I wish I had an explanation, but I just saw this and I thought, that is incredible. I mean, it's really interesting stuff. Some things are interesting just because they're interesting.
Yeah.
You know, they don't have impact, beyond what the story is itself. No political ramifications, no money, no controversy. It's just really kind of interesting.
That's what I think we need, something with no money, no controversy right now. We just have a good, feel-good kind of story. Thank you so much, Jim. Right. I appreciate it.
See you, Jim.
Bye. ABC's Jim Ryan. I know Alex probably saw that was my request last night and went, what? Why are we starting with that? But I just think that if you've got 500,000 people across the country who are in need of something like that, and you can use their own body to recreate the skin that they have lost in a burn accident, oh my gosh. I think that's amazing. And like Jim said, it's not that it's necessarily new, but it's starting to finally come out and be accepted more and be used more. And I just think that this is, anytime that they can come up new with something new in medicine and it can help us and it comes from our own bodies is fascinating to me. All right, let's get back to the news. The largest meat processing company in the world says IT problems caused by a ransomware attack could be fixed as early as today.
JBS Foods saying it's made significant progress recovering from the cyber attack that forced it to close plants in Texas, Nebraska, Colorado, Wisconsin, and Canada.
ABC's Andy Field says the company has been trying to restore operations since Sunday, and it says a Russian criminal organization is responsible for the attack. Little preview of what's ahead on your wake-up call at 5:35. We're going to talk about this with CNBC's Jane Wells. I just want to know if, because this was the largest meat processing company in the world, are we going to see an impact at all on our prices of meat, on the shortage? Is there going to be a shortage? Anything like that. So we'll talk with her at 5:35 about that portion. But then at 5:50, I've got a cyber expert on with us. He runs a company. It's a cyber defense company. And you've got the Colonial Gas Pipeline. You've got this one, JBS now, in the meat factory. I did the story yesterday, I don't know if you heard it, with Azusa PD being hacked a couple of months ago. How do companies prevent against this? Is JBS a good example of what a company can do to get hit by a ransomware attack and then be able to turn it around in just a couple of days? So I kind of want to dig into that part of it when we talk with Jack Blount, who is the CEO of Intrusion. That's a cyber defense company, coming up at 5:50. Amazon says it won't test potential customer or employees, that is, for weed anymore. Amazon says it's making the change because several states have legalized recreational marijuana use. We'll talk more about that with Jane coming up at 5:35 as well. An 18-year-old man has been shot to death in Lancaster during an argument with four other guys. LA County Sheriff's Department deputies responded to a call about the shooting yesterday and found a man lying in the street. He was taken to the hospital where he later died. The sheriff